Fake news has no place in a modern society. That declaration coming from President Marcos as he graces the International Conference of Information Commissioners in Pasay City. Let's get an update from our very own Katrina Domingo. Kat, over to you.
Fermina, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. urged all branches of government to genuinely uphold the public's right to freedom of information, saying that fake news should have no place in modern society. In a speech delivered before the International Conference of Information Commissioners, the president said that allowing the public access to government information is a key to the country's pursuit of good governance, improved public services, and a more progressive and sustainable society. Let's listen to a portion of that statement.
We also have to highlight that the FOI program has greatly advanced the campaign against misinformation and disinformation in the country, a problem that we in the Philippines also suffer from, as I guess all of us do around the world. Like everyone here, we too recognize as a matter of principle that fake news should have no place in modern society.
Fermina, the president adds the government will launch a digital, multimedia, and youth-oriented media and information literacy campaign to help Filipinos make informed decisions and to hold their representatives accountable without fear or apprehension. Marcos Jr. says his administration will strive to maintain a government that is not only effective and efficient, but also transparent and accountable to our people. But if we recall, in March 2023, the president signed an executive order that included more exceptions from the FOI policy, including school and health records of certain individuals. The government document underscored that personal information may only be disclosed to the public if it is a matter of public concern or interest, and if it does not meddle with or disturb the private life or family relations of the individual in question, thereby imposing quite tight conditions before the release of information to the public. Carmina.
Thanks a lot, Katrina Domingo, there joining us on the line. The Senate held necrological rites for the late Senator Rodolfo Biazon. The former Armed Forces Chief served in the upper chamber from 1992 to 1995, and then again from 1998 to 2010. Funeral rites will be held at Camp Aguinaldo Tuesday before he is laid to rest at the Libingan ng Mga Bayani. Biazon passed away on June 12th, Independence Day, at the age of 88. Well, two former senators issue calls for a return of decorum at the upper chamber, this following incidents of what can only be called unparliamentary behavior. More in this report.
Whether at the plenary or during committee hearings, several have highlighted the noise, the pointing, and the use of unparliamentary language at the Senate. Last May 17, Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri seemingly had enough of fellow senators loudly conversing in the middle of the session.
We had to suspend session because of a bit of unruly and noisy behavior in the back of the session floor. Of course, we have to remind ourselves that we are nationally elected leaders. We are senators of the Republic, and therefore we should always follow proper decorum.
The Senate leadership also criticized the insults and cursing during committee hearings.
I was asked by the Senate President then to look into the records also of the committee hearings, kasi may mga committee hearings din na may mga nasasabi na hindi dapat masabi at ma-strike off the record. So we will also, no, yung mga unparliamentary languages, kailangan ma-remind.
Senator Ronald De La Rosa admits to his offenses but couldn't help but compare himself to fellow senators.
Mukhang guilty ako kasi yung kapag sabi ako anak ng baka, di ba? That's very unparliamentary, di ba? Guilty ako nun. So I will magbago. At least ako hanggang anak ng baka lang ako, di ba? Yung iba talaga, mas iba yung mas mabigat yung pinagbibitaw na salita. Wala naman na kagalang-galang yung ating Senado, no? Mga senador tayo eh. Kaya we have to refrain from making unnecessary remarks.
Former Senate President Franklin Drilon and former Senator Panfilo Lacson are also dismayed at the behavior of some current members of the chamber.
I'm compelled to comment on what the public perceives to be an erosion of the prestige of the Senate as an institution principally brought about by what is perceived to be the lack of the quorum on the part of certain senators. The Senate is one of the pillars that must maintain its position as a pillar of democracy. So, and it can only maintain that position if it has the respect of the people.
In his Twitter post last June 4, Lacson pointed out that the word Senate means a chamber of mature, wise men. He tweeted again last Thursday, saying there's nothing wrong with winning an election through popularity or gimmickry. But Lacson added that once you take your oath of office, you stop being a showman and start becoming a statesman. Drilon issued an appeal to Zubiri.
Mabait siya si Migs, but he must draw the line. The upholding and restoring the prestige of the Senate is a burden on his shoulder. And therefore, he must see to it that the trust of the people in the Senate as an institution remains high.
Zubiri no longer wants to comment on the matter. In response to the criticisms, Senator Robin Padilla insists the new Senate is taking its job seriously in looking for solutions to the country's problems. He adds, the new Senate is not trying to make people laugh, especially with the weight of the problems they inherited from previous senators. Senator Jinggoy Estrada, meanwhile, agrees that each lawmaker should be responsible for their words and actions because of how it affects the Senate's reputation and public trust. He says, all senators should strive to become role models of professionalism and set examples for future generations of legislators.
Well, U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken meets with China's top diplomat in Beijing. Blinken sat down with Wang Yi on the final day of a high-stakes visit to Beijing aimed at stabilizing relations between the two superpowers. Reports say a meeting between Blinken and Chinese President Xi Jinping is also expected, but this has yet to be confirmed by Washington. Blinken earlier met with Chinese Foreign Minister Qin Gang Sunday. The 7.5-hour meeting yielded a pledge from both sides to keep the conversation going with an eventual meeting in Washington. The U.S. State Department also said both sides showed a desire to reduce tensions during the meeting. Well, the Philippines, the U.S. and Japan agreeing to increase maritime activities in the West Philippine Sea, citing what they call unilateral attempts to change the status quo by force. The national security advisors of the three countries made that commitment during their first trilateral meeting in Tokyo late last week. This comes on the heels of the first joint exercises of the Coast Guards of the U.S., Japan, and the Philippines earlier this month. The three allies also plan to boost efforts in humanitarian assistance and disaster relief. The Philippine Coast Guard insists it will not be intimidated by China following Beijing's latest act of aggression. Last Friday, a Chinese Navy ship shadowed one of the PCG's vessels as it was returning to Palawan after it helped deliver livelihood assistance to residents on Pag-asa Island. Coast Guard spokesperson on the West Philippine Sea, Jay Tariela, says their personnel did not stop issuing a radio challenge to the Chinese Navy to insist they were encroaching on Philippine territory.
That's the usual practice that they have been doing naman. For so many occasions, we have already reported this, no? Na ang AIS ng Chinese Coast Guard, even the Philippine Navy vessel, ay pinapatay nila. Sa Pag-asa po, ay meron tayong 12 nautical miles sa territorial. Hindi sir, dahil tayo po ay may deep sa territorial sea natin dito sa Pag-asa. AIS is a requirement ng international convention. It would be proper kung sakaling lahat tayo ay naka-turn on ng ating mga AIS. Kasi this has something to do with safety, no? For other vessels to monitor your presence.
Beijing claims sovereignty over almost the entire South China Sea, ignoring an international ruling that they assert has no legal basis. International studies professor believes Filipinos are against using the resources of the Philippines to help Afghan refugees. Manila is currently evaluating Washington's request to allow the temporary stay of refugees who fled the Taliban government. More than its negative side effects, Professor Renato De Cacha sees a business opportunity for the Philippines in this request.
Also have to take into account security concerns. That's a valid concern. But at the same time, we also have to look at it. What do we get out of this? I don't think even the United States would think that the Philippines would spend a single cent for those Afghan for that Afghan processing center. I don't think that's on the table.
Yeah,
I think everything will be spent paid by the U.S. government, mm-hmm. and of course supported by the United Nations. What I see is, of course, business prospects on the part of the government in terms of constructing those sites, in terms of maintaining those sites,